please join me in welcoming Priscilla Presley, John Eddy, and Mike Arnold.
Wow, it's a lot of people here.
I watched a bunch of episodes over the weekend, and I was reminded of that story that Steve Martin told of meeting Elvis and you after you both saw a performance by a very young Steve Martin in 1971. Martin described seeing these two figures walking towards his dressing room after his show. The first was a beautiful woman who, of course, turned out to be Priscilla. And then he saw a vision in a white jumpsuit with a huge belt buckle. And of course, that was Elvis. And he immediately said to Steve Martin, "Son, you have an oblique sense of humor." And I was reminded of that remark seeing this show. When working with you on The Searcher, I came to learn that Elvis also had an oblique sense of humor. Some of his favorite movies of the 70s were the Monty Python movies, the Mel Brooks movies. And based on the episodes I've seen so far, the series seems driven by that same oblique sense of humor. As well as Elvis's lifelong fascination with superheroes and comic books and his fantasies of fighting crime and evil. Priscilla and John, is that an accurate read on the Elvis legacy that informs this show? And can you tell us how all of those things came together in this series?
Absolutely, it's true. I mean, Elvis had kind of a sick sense of humor, to be honest with you. Things made him laugh. Like, you kind of look at him, first of all, I mean, I'll never forget the first time Grandma was his grandmother, and she lived at Graceland, and she didn't have many teeth, and she'd talk, you know, with that chewing tobacco in the back of her mouth, and Elvis would say, "Grandma, spit that stuff out. That's not good for you." And she goes, I'm not doing anything like that. I'm going to chew this stuff." So he said, "Grandma, this is not very ladylike." And she goes, "Oh, shut up. You don't know what a lady's like." But anyway, she got up out of her chair. She tripped and fell on the floor. And she didn't hurt herself. But Elvis's sense of humor, he fell over on the floor laughing because he couldn't believe his grandmother was sitting there, and she's going, "Well, goddamn it, help me up." Don't laugh. The two of them had a great sense of humor and played a lot with each other. But he was fun to be with and had a great sense of humor and a great laugh. And what was the question?
Let me turn it over to the next part over to John and Elvis's fascination with fighting evil and also like comic books and superheroes.
Yeah, well, apparently it wasn't all fantasy. Like Priscilla told me a story where they were driving somewhere and there was a fight going on at a gas station, and Elvis right. jumped out, and you know, the fight stopped because it's like, that's Elvis.
It was here in LA. In a gas station, actually.
Yeah.
Elvis saw a fight going on, and he looked and he says, "Damn it." You know, and he gets out, stops the car, had our driver stop, and he went out there and he goes, whoa, wait a minute. And they're really banging it up, and they both stop and look at him, and he goes, "That's Elvis Presley." And the other one says, "That's not Elvis Presley." He says, that's Elvis Presley. And he backs up and takes a look. And he goes, I mean, it stopped the fight, absolutely. They wanted autographs and became friends after. Elvis had a good talk with him, though.
And it's the whole, like, obvious, you know, there was the famous, you know, photo of Elvis with Richard Nixon where he was offering his services to be a DEA agent. So, I mean, that was the basis of the kicking off of the idea of making this show. And, you know, we had talked, and when we first started putting it together and coming up with ideas, so many of the things that are in the show, like the fact that there's a monkey. He had a monkey, Scatter.
It was a real chimpanzee.
Monkey. Yeah, chimpanzee. Oh, yeah, I forgot. That's the wrong word, monkey, I guess. So there's so many things that we could, you know, use as springboards for episode ideas, for story ideas that were based always in some form of Elvis's life. You know, he has that famous speech in front of the, when he won the JC's award for the Young Man of the Year, he said he always wanted to be the hero in a comic book. And that was the why we made it, as opposed to doing a live action thing or something, we specifically want to do animated. Also because, and you know, all due respect, you know, Austin Butler did an amazing job, and other people have done, you know, absolutely. But I've been a big Elvis fan since I was a little kid, and even as great as anybody does it, they can never like capture Elvis's love. He was such a beautiful man, you know. It's like he's just crazy, and so we thought maybe through animation. But that even turned into the like Robert Valley, the designer who did the character designs, is a genius, and he said Elvis was like one of the hardest people he ever had to, you know, design the character for, because if you get one thing wrong, it changes the face, and because he was so perfect looking.
That's a great segue into my next question for you, Priscilla. Matthew McConaughey is so good in this. It's sort of transformational. How did you come to have the hunch that he'd be the right person to depict Elvis here?
Well, obviously, I mean, he's got a great voice, and he's got that southern voice and deep voice, and we discussed other people, but Matthew just kept coming into mind, and knowing that he could he's such a professional, and that he would do a great job at speaking for Elvis, and I loved him in it. He has that southern drawl, and Elvis did too in many ways. When he'd get back to Memphis, he'd pick it all up at once. Back here in California, he tried to talk Californian. But yeah, I thought he did a great job. He really did.
Mike, let me ask you, it's beyond Matthew, it's such a great cast with Caitlin Olsen and Johnny Knoxville, Niecy Nash, Tom Kenny, and Don Cheadle. And each of them plays such memorable characters. And for example, in Caitlin's character, I feel the vibes of Emma Peel from the British series The Avengers. Or in Scatters, I feel like the gonzo, outrageous character of like Hunter Thompson. Could you talk about fleshing out these characters and the world that they inhabit?
Well, first off, I'm stuck on what would I do if I was in a fight in a parking lot and Elvis walked up to me at a gas station? There's got to be something you could work with that. That's really cool for those guys. Good idea to get in a fight there. With Elvis, we were always thinking, he's so quintessentially cool, right? I mean, who doesn't want to be as cool as Elvis? Which is one of the reasons I think Matthew is a great fit. Who doesn't want to be as cool as Matthew McConaughey? To find that nice, just, you know, ensemble to go around him, everybody with a little bit different. You know, you think coked up chimp with a shotgun, Tom Kenny. Okay, yeah, I'm watching. That sounds awesome. And, you know, and CeCe would bring, while Elvis had that, you know, that sort of mainline cool that just courses through the show, we bring that sort of wonderful frenetic energy that Caitlin does so well, right? And can really play off that. And then Don Cheadle's kind of his own kind of swagger with a little bit of crazy on top of it for his character, and really trying to make everybody kind of move around that Elvis cool to create that ensemble, I think, that works really well on the show.
Can you just tell us a little bit about yourself growing up, what Elvis meant to you?
Oh, yeah. Well, so I grew up in the South. I'm from Georgia. I don't live in L.A. I'm not nearly cool enough to live in this town. So, but yeah, I grew up in Georgia, and you know, from Tennessee down to Georgia, my parents were from Tennessee. I mean, Elvis is, as Priscilla can speak to more than anybody, he's on a different plane. There's Elvis, and then there's kind of everything else that you know is going on. And it was just my first introduction to music was really, you know, Elvis. That's what my parents played. They were Elvis fans, Elton John fans. I don't know if those two go hand in hand, but that's what played in my house all day long. 8-tracks, old school, the good stuff. Wish I still had them. And yeah, it's just he's a big part of just the world. And one of the challenges, I think, with the show was, and John and I talked about this a lot, he was really the first worldwide superstar. I mean, he invented the concept that other people have taken. He was the first global icon, if you want to use that term. So in that regard, it's a big responsibility, and it was you know, something that we had a lot of fun with, but always kept in mind.
John, the look of this show is incredible. You know, I see hints of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, you know, the Tarantino movie. There's like throwbacks to Elvis, That's the Way It Is. Can you tell us about working with Sony Animation to develop the look of the series?
Well, early on, when we first started developing the show with Sony Animation, which has been so supportive and with the whole idea. And, you know, we said there's two versions of the show. there's the shitty, stupid version, and there's the cool version. And our goal was hopefully to make the cool version. And that was always like our touchstone and our guiding light. Like, it had to be, in our mind, cool. And it started with Robert Valley. As soon as we saw his designs, we didn't even look at another artist designs. It was like, that was it for us. And then Fletcher Moulis, who's also and producer on the show, and also is a brilliant director. He did Kid Cudi, Intergalactic on Netflix. He directed that. Absolutely. Let's hear for Fletcher. He's here tonight.
Yeah.
So, but when we would talk about, you know, our ideas for the show, we did use a lot of 70s movies and 60s movies, like the split screen. We had grain on the images, so it would look like a 70s movie. When we pitched it first to Sony, that was it. We said, Elvis in an animated show, fighting crime, as if directed by Quentin Tarantino.
Priscilla, I know that you've always been very aware of design and fashion aesthetics. And in fact, I remember you talking to me about the design of the Graceland Hotel in Memphis and how you wanted it to be tasteful and artistic, and you would take pieces of the fabric from Elvis's jumpsuits and frame them in ways that suggested the motif but also were kind of aesthetically calming and pleasing. And I noticed that John Varvatos did the design of Elvis's wardrobe in the animation here. How did that relationship come about?
Well, I've always loved John Varvatos. I mean, his taste, his look. I mean, if Elvis were here today, he would definitely be wearing John Varvatos clothes. John actually came to Memphis, and our archivist there, Angie, took us into the room, which is like going into a vault. We had all the books out on Elvis's clothes that Bill Ballou, who was his designer of the jumpsuits, and some actual suits that he would wear out in public. Elvis loved his design, and Bill Ballou just had him down to a T. And so John was fascinated, literally, with the clothes that Elvis had. Angie brought out some of the pieces, and he was just in awe. I was taking pictures of him as he was looking, unbeknownst to him, just going through the fabrics, looking at the clothes that Elvis wore, and they were all unique, and no one ever actually dressed like him. It was his own style. As a young boy, he used to go to movies. His favorite actors were Tony Curtis, and he would look at him, and why would he look so different? You know, he had dark hair, and he had these great eyes, and Elvis just really was captivated not only movies, but the making of movies and the people who were involved with movies. He would, late at night, would go to the movies. He would rent a theater, and I'll never forget, Humphrey Bogart was in this movie, and it was about the third time I met him. And I would hear this whispering, and it was just me and Elvis Joe Esposito, a couple of guys that worked with him. And he would be whispering, and I'm going, oh my God, he talks to himself. You know, this is really kind of strange. I don't know. You know, I mean, is there anyone around? I'm looking, and Joe is sitting there watching, and he's just really having a conversation with himself. And I'm going, I feel a little bit uncomfortable here. What he was doing is he knew every single line that Humphrey Bogart had. He had it all down. He saw the movie only twice, and he had his lines down. So that's how much of a perfectionist he was. He was detail-oriented. And he was one of a kind, I mean, in every way. His clothing, the material, the jewelry that he wore. And he was his own guy. I mean, he really started, actually, you know, Sammy Davis Jr. would come and he'd start to imitate. If you'd see Sammy Jr., he was starting to dress a little bit like Elvis. So he was his own guy, his own taste, in his own world that he loved very, very much. But he just stood out.
Mike, as we get into the season, we see clips of Star Trek and other iconic 60s and 70s films. And we also get a sense of kind of spy shows like Mission Impossible and I Spy. But there's also this very modern sensibility, kind of akin to Archer, which I know you worked on. Tell me about building the mythology of the show and the language of the show and the references in the show.
Well, first off, I just want to note that it was wild seeing Elvis's The Archives of the Clothes. And the one thing I walked away from, besides being blown away, was those jumpsuits are heavy. I mean, if I had to put one of those on, I'd be crying, need to go take a nap. I mean, how? It's amazing. I mean, it's like, anyway, it just struck me. I go, God, you have to be in such shape to wear these things. Very cool. As far, what was the question? I'm sorry, I was just talking about everybody's
just about building the mythology
gotcha.
Of the show. And,
absolutely.
You know.
Absolutely. One of the most fun things, we had many things that John and I enjoyed working on this, was the idea of, you know, we called it sort of the Forrest Gump of it all, which is Elvis walking through history, hitting on these fun moments in time, impacting them. And it wasn't just that, selecting those moments and making an episode out of that. But also from episode to episode, we made a very deliberate attempt to create our own vocabulary for each character. Like, okay, what are we going to learn new about Cece? What does she sound like this episode? What does Elvis sound like this episode? And trying to build on that, because I think a lot of fun shows are you build that vocabulary over the course of the season to where by the time you arrive at episode 10, you've got your own voice for the entire show. Every character has their own voice, and they're all hopefully singing together in their own weird way.
I just want to say one thing. When you were talking earlier, you were talking about like the drugs that was the drugs that was going on in the early 70s. That was one of the reasons why Elvis wanted to be an agent, a federal agent, was he wanted to stop what was happening, the movement that was going on back in the day. And it was, you know, a lot of drugs happening, a lot of kids dying. And he went to Nixon so that he could be a federal agent and help and stop, you know, what was going on in our time.
John, what were you thinking about? What were the priorities in weaving the music of Elvis Presley into this series?
We tried to, besides, you know, getting the big hits that everybody knows, we dig a little deeper and have a little more obscure songs in it. But again, to Mike's point, we were talking about there's a Forrest Gump aspect of the show where we follow a real timeline. The show starts, first season starts in 68 and goes up into the early 70s. And we also hit upon some, like, you know, we have David Bowie music in the show. We have The Doors in the show. We have Jefferson Airplane. We have Robert Goulet. And when I was a kid, I wanted to be the next Elvis Presley. My backup plan was to be the next Bruce Springsteen. I ended up being me, and it worked out all right. It's like, now I have a show with Elvis Presley in it. So, you know, it's been an inspiration. Elvis was absolutely the first thing. My grandmother was a big Elvis fan. My mom was a big Elvis fan. So anybody who's worth their salt wants to be the next Elvis Presley. So anyway. Yeah.
One last question for each of you. What was the most memorable experience in working on this show?
Just working on it and going over the script and making sure that it was right and that it was Elvis. And these are the things that he would do. The most memorable thing, I think, is Scatter, though, because Scatter was to be remembered. Scatter did all those things. Scatter escaped. Scatter went into Bel Air and people's windows and scared them to death. And there were police coming in on Scatter all the time because he would escape. So I think I was there when that happened. We had a place in Bel Air, and he escaped a lot. And the neighbors just wanted us to get rid of him. Can you imagine them peeking in the windows and looking at him and going, get this creature out of here. What the heck is it? So Scatter is a real deal.
For me, we first started talking about this idea in 2012. We pitched it to Sony in 2014. And it's, so you can just see how long, by the time Netflix, you know, was 2018 or 19. And it's taken a long time. And I just want to say one thing. You know, it was weird, like, talking about, because, you know, Priscilla, you know, this is her life, and this is an alternate reality version of it. And I think that something that's so important is that she let the writers, you know, push the envelope and go get edgy, because she's an actress and she's been in the Naked Gun movie, so she knows comedy. So it might not, it's not a documentary about Elvis, obviously. So we do things, but we've always tried to stay true to what Elvis and Priscilla's, you know, version of Elvis, but with the knowledge that we were trying to make a crazy show. So I just think it was big applause. Thank you for letting us do that.
I also think, too, that what I love so much about it is introducing Elvis to the youth today and wondering why, you know, he was so famous, and to see him a hero. And I know that this is a dream come true for Elvis, because this is really what he wanted to do. He wanted to be a federal agent. And for me, I've always wanted to give Elvis what he wanted and never really quite made it. But he was a beautiful human being and a very talented human being, and I want kids to see who he really was in this, because he really was. He wanted to be an agent, and now he is. So yeah. It's all.
Yeah, I was going to say we had a celebration dinner once when we closed the deal with Sony, and Jerry Schilling was there, who is, you know, Elvis's best friend. And we were, you know, we had had the Bible written up and everything, and then Jerry stood up and said that out of all the projects they've been involved in, he thought Elvis would like this one the most, just because, like you said, it was his dream. So
I remember, it was the moment you remember the most. It's an easy one. So everybody here has been involved in making animation, and you know, especially when you're working out the pilot episode, you're living through the script line by line, you're figuring out, you're building the world, the images, the voices, you're selecting every line, you're working frame by frame, every single thing. And I remember very well, and I know John does too, because I was really loud when we did this, when we finished that last mix session, right? We're done. We do the final watch through. And right when it was done, I just stopped and remember, and I said too loud, I go, wow, that's a fucking TV show right there. because it came out the way we wanted. We were all so happy. It took a while to get there. All these things take time, but it was very gratifying, I think, for all of us to feel it just come home and like, oh, shit, that was a lot of fun. So that's the one I remember the most, finishing that last mix session of the pilot.
Fantastic. Well, Priscilla, John, Mike, thank you so much for being with us this evening.
Thank you.